Good afternoon, everybody. So this instruction course basically is a refractive surgery for all. So understanding LASIK, now refractive surgery has become a basic procedure in the ophthalmic practice. So this session will try to cover right from diagnostics to options, LASIK, then say phakic implants in detail. We'll try to cover maximum. So first speaker is Dr. Purnima. She'll be covering the pre-LASIK topography and abrometry.
Thank you for the introduction, sir. In this, as the topic of the symposium is refractive surgery for all, and as sir has said, we are going to discuss the entire gamut. The first step in this journey is to understand what is your patient's cornea, so that whatever is the cornea, you will be able to give the treatment for that patient. And that's what is my topic all about. I have no financial interest. When the cornea is grossly pathological, any of the diagnostic modalities, including the simplest, can bring about, can be diagnosed. But when we are screening for refractive surgery, the goal is to not miss any eye that is not normal, right? And for this, it is important that of all the currently available topography machines, the Scheimpflug tomography are the ones with the best diagnostic ability. And hence, I would be focusing in the interest of time mainly on the Scheimpflug imaging. But I think at the end of it, irrespective of the machine you are using, you should be able to judge and make a call or take a call on what patients you need to operate upon and which surgery to go for. Right, the first step is to check the acquisition, which has to be a good quality scan. Right, then we move on to the curvature maps. Okay. Look for the K-max, the maximum keratometry on the sagittal anterior, and if it is less than 48, that is a good call for you. More than that is definitely abnormal or needs further evaluation. Also have a look at the actual topography on the sagittal anterior. We can classify them as the symmetric ones, like the round, the oval, the symmetric bow tie, and the symmetric oblique. Here, most of them will be normal unless, again, the K-max is on the higher side. Then the asymmetrical ones have the superior steepening or the inferior steepening, or the asymmetric bow tie with the superior or inferior steepening. Here, again, you have to see for the K-values on opposite points between 3 to 5 meridian, and an approximate judgment is that it should be less than 2.5 diopters for superior steepening and less than 1.5 for inferior. Again, if there is a skewed radial axis between the asymmetric bow tie, that's usually not a good sign. But with the rampant use of contact lenses, sometimes it may still be seen. And if the axis is less than 22 diopters, it may be normal and can be observed to see if it remains the same. These are, of course, definitely abnormal patterns. The next is on the pachymetry map, look for the thinnest. Now, this is not an indicator of whether you can do refractive surgery or not, but if the thinnest is less than 470, that is definitely abnormal. That itself is a red flag. The next, you have to look at the Y coordinate to see the inferior displacement of that thinnest point. If it is less than minus 0.5, that is normal. More than minus 1 is definitely abnormal. Now, the main important part which distinguishes Scheimpflug imaging from anything is the elevation maps. And if you see over here, it is basically the points on the cornea which are above or below a best fit sphere. Now in pentacam, the sphere is in such a way that a normal spherical prolate cornea will have a steep area in the center which will rise above the reference plane, a flattening in the mid periphery, and again a steepening in the periphery, giving to a central island. Whereas a toric cornea will have the steep axis falling below the reference and the flat axis rising above, giving a rise to this hourglass pattern. But in cirrus, this reference pattern is usually an automated one which is fit such that the apex of the reference matches the apex of the cornea in normal cases and relatively normal cases, and therefore, whether it's spherical or toric, you will still get an hourglass pattern with an approximate zero value in the center. The shape of the elevation map is usually not important because it depends upon this, but if you get such a tongue-shaped extension into the elevation map, that's definitely abnormal. The values, now for Pentagam, you have documented and researched cutoffs, which is separate for myopia and hyperopia. But because of the difference in the way the elevation is calculated for Cirrus and Pentagam, I would like to have a much more, lesser cutoffs for the anterior and posterior elevation so that you can be safe in all cases. But the most important point is the coinciding of the highest anterior and posterior elevation with the thinnest pachymetry. And this is one thing that you should look for whenever you're screening a patient for refractive surgery. Let's see an example. Now, this is a definitely abnormal cornea, but let's see the parameters. The Kmax is more than 48 diopters. Thinnest pachy is less than is 444 with an decentration more than minus 0.95. There's an asymmetric bow tie with an inferior steepening and also skewed radial axis, which is more than 22 degrees, and the superior inferior K difference is significant. The highest K elevation on anterior and posterior maps are abnormal, but the most important is that it is coinciding with this. So there is no need actually to see a KC summary in such a case. This is definitely abnormal. All parameters will be abnormal. Now let us see this interesting case. This is a Cirrus. Here the K values are, K max is normal. Right, the thickness is normal. Okay. There is a borderline decentration of the inferior, which is the first red flag. The anterior, the KS superior inferior difference, again is very borderline, may be considered as a red flag. The anterior elevation is absolutely normal, but the posterior elevation as per the cutoffs is definitely a point to be noted. And again, as I said, the take-home message has to be that you, if it is coinciding, be careful. Now, every Scheimpflug is giving you different indices. Most of the indices do work perfectly fine for keratoconus, but all of them are not so great for screening subclinical. But definitely in this, there are six parameters. What you are actually checking here is in comparison to the normative, what is your anterior elevation and pachymetry differences. And that is what is being checked. And out of the 11 parameters, almost five parameters are abnormal. And then that is why you have the suspect keratoconus. And you should definitely keep this in mind before you plan any surgery for this patient. Right? So this cements the fact that was being given by Dr. Bellin, that posterior corneal surface is now recognized as a sensitive indicator of corneal disease and can be abnormal even when the anterior and pachy is normal. Let's move on to the second half of the talk, that is understanding aberrations. What are aberrations? They are nothing but imperfections of the human optical system, and they influence the visual outcome, and that is why are important. They are measured basically using different aberrometers. These are the principles on which the various commercially available aberrometers are working on. Now, with the aspect of understanding the wavefront, the simplest would be to see a Hartmann-Shack. So this is the Xi-Wave that is one of the Hartmann-Shack-based aberrometers. What it does is there is a point source, a ray of light from that is focused onto the retina. And the image on the retina acts as another force. It passes through the aberrations of the human optical system to form this wavefront. This is then passed through a series of lens slits, and each of them will be focused into a multiple point. So this is about one point, and imagine all those multiple points that are reflected. So from this lens slit, whatever is reflected back. So you'll get multiple waves. And when this is compared with an ideal point, the point of focus, it will show either a form of displacement, which is an indicator of aberration, or blurring, which is an indicator of scatter. So this is a relatively normal eye, which the wavefront, whereas this is the output with a highly aberrated eye. Now imagine every ray or wavefront which is in phase will form one color. So all the reds are in phase, all the yellows are in phase, and all the blue are in phase. What is the difference is the lag between them. And this lag is what gives you these different shapes and that forms the Zernike polynomials. Always remember, aberrations that are towards the center, they are more harmful for the visual quality than those in the periphery, right? Further to understand it, let's see this case. This is a case of simple myopia with a very small cylinder. Okay, her higher order aberrations for 5 and 6 millimeter are normal. So the normal would be considered, say, around 0.35 to 0.5, 0.4 microns, less than that, right? So this is the total wavefront. But this is mainly influenced by this minus 5D focus. So we just remove that and we check the higher order wavefront and its point spread function. Okay, so this is the quality of the eye. Now I have tried to reconstruct that out of all the 12 main polynomials, which are the ones that will give an almost similar pattern. And here we see that these are the third order aberrations. That is the coma and the trefoil. Now the same patient, other eye, is having a high cylinder. And you see that there is a slightly different higher order wavefront. But again, if you try to reconstruct, you are getting mainly a third order with a slight tetrafoil, which is there. Okay, and the higher order aberrations are also in the normal range. Now this is the third case, again around the same amount of cylinder of 2.25. But if you look at the higher order aberrations, they are very high. Okay, also if you try to reconstruct, here you are seeing this pattern which is slightly seems more abnormal. And when you are seeing besides the third order, you also have fourth and fifth orders that are playing a role. Okay, this is a very good article about clinical aspects of aberrometry in the Belgium Society of Ophthalmology, which helps you understand that in myopia, any refractions that there are the common aberrations are third order aberrations. And if you do a refractive surgery for the previous patient, after the refractive surgery, this third order gets converted more into the fourth order. This case, however, is a patient of keratoconus. So if you see the cylinder, but the aberrations are much more, that is because she is a patient of keratoconus. So just coming to the last two slides, to understand that the aberrometry is definitely pupil dependent. If you're planning a acquisition, the pupil size has to be more than whatever is the optic zone that you're planning. Central aberrations, as I said, affect vision more. Interactions of different aberrations are complex. So just because they have aberrations doesn't mean their visual quality is going to be affected, because inter-individual things can actually improve or worsen the case. There is a lot of individual variation in the neural processing that happens of these aberrations. So just because your eye has aberration doesn't mean the brain is going to assess, is going to detect it, right? And the wavefront scans, that is why, because of all these reasons, are not always repeatable. Wavefront guided treatments have higher ablation per diopter as compared to the aspheric treatments. That is something you need to know. And refractive surgeries, all of them, as I have mentioned before, themselves induce higher order aberrations. So from all this, what points that we can take up clinically for aberrations is, if you're planning a wavefront guided treatment, check that there are higher order aberrations, which is more than the cutoff, okay, that this actually clinically significant. And of course, you can also plan them for aberrated. Definitely you need to plan them if they are aberrated eyes, like previous refractive treatment with a decentered ablation or customized ablation for specific higher order aberrations. For example, in keratoconic eyes, if you're specifically targeting coma, then this might be definitely helpful. Another option in such corneas is don't do anything for the wavefront, but you just regularize the surface by doing a topography guided surgery and then proceed with it. So I think I've covered, kind of covered everything. And let's see now for what every different type of patients, what all you can do. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Purnima. So based upon the diagnostic topography and say wavefront analysis of the patient, along with the basic investigations, you can decide what kind of surgery you have to choose for your patient. Our next topic is basically decision making in interesting scenario, covered by Dr. Mukesh Pariyani.
Hello, yeah. So after understanding the topography in detail, let's see some of the interesting case scenarios that we come across in our practice. My first case is what I call machine versus machines. He was a 36-year-old male who came for refractive surgery. After reading a lot on internet, the refractive error was minus 6 and minus 6.25. For this discussion purpose, I'll just consider the right eye. The condition was similar in both the eyes. So this was a dual Scheinflug image which we had taken and was showing the keratometry values were within normal, but there was some irregularities which were seen. After this, this showed the pachymetry, good distribution of pachymetry was seen. But there was some posterior elevation seen on the map, which was repeated. So it's not that he had taken a one scan and we just booked on that. But yeah, we did a repeated scan, and there was this posterior elevation, which was seen. Rest of all the parameters were absolutely normal. So this made us suspicious, while the second machine was Cirrus, was showing a lesser PACI. So the first machine, if you note, showed a PACI of 531, while this was showing a PACI of around 499. Remember, the refractive error is around minus 6. And the surface looks pretty much normal. There was no elevation seen on the anterior or the posterior map. So one machine showing something different, the other machine showing something different. We did one more Placido, and on Placido everything was normal. Aberrations of 1.4, 1.1 is fairly okay. So what should we rely on these cases? Dual Scheimpflug, which was showing an irregular cornea. Scheimpflug with Placido was showing a thin but regular cornea. Placido was showing a regular cornea. And what should be done in these cases? Well, this was a time when, you know, we actually thought of doing a LASIK extra for this patient, because he knew and he had read about this, and we planned a LASIK extra in this patient. Very, very controversial, but I think for this particular patient it worked. We recently had a 3-year follow-up of this patient, and he is still doing pretty well. Case 2, similar, 36-year-old female. Coming up for a refractive error of minus 5, average K values, pachymetry good, topo normal, everything was normal. The only thing that I asked her is, at the age of 36, suddenly refractive surgery could have gone it for earlier, at an earlier stage. She said, yeah, but I'm just feeling something abnormal since the past few months, and somebody told me, why didn't you just go for a refractive surgery and finish it off? So these kind of recent changes in the vision, you know, warranted something else, and I sent the patient for an eye trace to see. These are the higher order aberration, not the lower order. Most of the aberrations were coming basically from the lens itself and not from the cornea, and perhaps this was what troubling the patient. So this was a 36-year-old patient with a specific complaint, but any patient now who comes after the age of 40, I do the internal aberration test also to make sure that the lens is not having any kind of mathematical cataract or lens-induced aberrations. So by rule, after 40, I do an aberrometry to make sure that there's no aberrations coming from inside the eye. So this particular patient, very typical, everything was coming from the lens. So we offered a lens-based procedure for her, and she got a pretty good vision after a simple cataract surgery. One more 21-year-old male who wanted to go for refractive surgery. The refraction not very high, minus 2, minus 2.25, rest of the parameters are normal, kappa is normal. IOP a little on the higher side, 26, but that can be attributed to a PACI of 640. Pretty flat cornea, 39. These are the corneas which are very prone to flap-related complications when we are doing particularly the microkeratome. Femtosecond would be perhaps safer in these cases, but very flat cornea, pachymetry of 640. Now, 640 first immediately warrants us to do a specular microscopy in these cases. This is the right eye of the patient. This is the left eye. Absolutely similar. Surprisingly, the brother of the patient also had a similar PACI, and he had also been planned for a refractive surgery. And similar PACI, absolutely similar PACI. Although the op scan overestimates thicker cornea, but we got the confirmation of the PACI using other two instruments also. The specular microscopy in this case was normal in both the eyes, and clinically also was normal. So what would you do in this case? Flap LASIK? Perhaps yes, you can go for flap LASIK, but a microkeratome LASIK would be a little risky because of too much a flat cornea. Femtosecond, yes, would be perhaps safer. What we planned for this particular patient was a surface ablation. Smile, a minus 2, the lenticle would be thin, but still it can be, it's doable. For this particular patient, we went ahead and did a surface ablation. To our surprise, everything went fine, but the patient turned out to be a steroid responder. So he developed raised pressures and blurred vision, which slowly on topical anti-glaucoma subsided over 2 weeks of time. But now we are in a dilemma, because to prevent the haze, we have to give a longer steroid. At the same time, we have to control the pressure. So these kind of tricky situations, we have to manage as it comes. You can't just predict how it's going to go. The dilemma is now the brother, which we have to do a refractive surgery, what should we go for? Will the same Paki will have the same steroid responder also? We still don't know that. This was a 43-year-old guy who came and he's like, I play cricket pretty regularly and something if you can do, give me a good vision without glasses and stuff. And the refractive error was -7 in the right and -5 in the left eye. The op scan showing the regular keratometry, the keratometry was normal, no elevation, but the Paki was around 490. The refraction is -7. 490 again, and the refractive is around -5. So here, if we correct the right eye, perhaps we'll have a residual stromal bed of less than 300, considering a regular flap of around 120 microns. What would you do? Will you do a LASIK? Would you do a SMILE? Or also, you have to consider about the presbyopia. Currently, he's having everything reading, which is pretty good. And considering the lifestyle, what would you do? This is up to the panel to actually decide. One can actually go for a surface procedure in this, and surface procedure with a mitomycin C will be pretty good outcomes in this particular patient. Only thing is the right eye, we might have to undercorrect a little bit because -7 with a refractive error with a 490 Paki might be a little suspicious at a later part of the date. So these are very tricky situations. A job doesn't end here. What about the we don't have to just take care of these patients who are coming. What about the patients who have undergone LASIK long back and now comes up with those decentered ablations, irregular astigmatism, or the central islands, and they have cataract with them. For these, you have to actually just try and make the regularize the surface before implanting the intraocular lenses. This is a very much a published data. What you do is you do a topoguided treatment for the surface, you regularize the surface, and then after stabilization of the keratometry values documented at a 6 weeks interval, perhaps you can plan the biometry based on that, and later on do a cataract surgery, which will give you much, much higher and a better visual quality. So if this is something was pre-ablation when the patient presented, this is the ablation profile, this is what you get post-ablation, and pretty much regular cornea where you can plan your post-IOL calculation based on the EACRS calculator, you can do that. Similarly, say the same sheet. So this is pre-ablation and this is post-ablation, pretty much regular corneas we can see here. So if you can just point out here, the corneal abrasion before the surgery was around 0.7, which after the topoguided treatment turns out to 0.170, which is fairly acceptable. So this is, if this is the simulation of what patient presented with, this is what the patient gets after a topoguided treatment, still blurred because of the cataract we have not yet tackled. What he has after cataract surgery is pretty much a good visual quality. The, just to end my talks, these are just interesting topographies. You see the pretty much normal, the thickness is 545, not much of a skewing, regularly looking cornea, but again the posterior elevation of 15. This is the left eye of the patient, again the posterior elevation of 17, definitely 550 Paki, 560 Paki, fairly good Paki, but still, whatever the refractive error, these patients are certainly not fit for the refractive surgery. The Bellin confirming the same, the posterior elevation here we can see, this is right eye and the left eye both. This is again the patient with fairly good looking topography, normal, no anterior elevation. Paki is close to 575, but the posterior elevation is showing in both the eyes, right eye as well as the left eye. So these are the things that we have to be aware of in this case. Suppose if I am in a practice where I don't have a Placido, I'll be pretty happy to see this topography and doing a ultrasound Paki, I'll be very happy that it's got 570. But when we can be a little unfortunate, the patient is having a posterior elevation and that can be caught on a Scheinflug imaging only. So thank you for your kind attention.
Mukesh, all your cases were worth discussing, so we'll switch over. We have time.
Yeah.
So second case which you projected, which has a lenticular aberrations.
Yes.
With age.
Yes.
So if the patient age was 36 or 40 years, below
yes.
40. So in the same patient, we could have opted for, say, wavefront guided treatment also simultaneously instead of doing cataract or lens exchange. That was again an option.
Yes.
The third case, which flat cornea.
Yes, sir.
So with the kind of all the microkeratomes you get in market are linear now.
Yeah, they are linear.
So again, whatever, however thin flat cornea, you can do a flap surgery in that case also.
Sir, also I wanted to ask your take. So if there's a PACI is 640.
Yeah, that's a, so those are genuinely interesting cases, what we are discussing. Huh. That's the reason I'm doing.
So 640 PACI, even in this case, the endothelium was absolutely normal.
Absolutely.
Will you
okay.
go for a flap based or you will go for a surface based?
And probably in his brother's case, probably if you do a flap LASIK, that will help you. Because that it won't require that kind of steroid treatment post-operatively.
And his earlier pressure was 26, as you had said.
That might be because of the PECI.
Post-surgery also maintained 26,
so that,
28.
That means the steroid responder in this case would be better off with a flap-based surgery.
Yes. After duly explaining the risk of microkeratome in flat corneas, I think we'll opt for the.
And another thing is that there's minus 7 with a PACI of 540, you said,
490.
Topographically. Topograph.
Yes, yes.
I never consider a PACI of topography because it always overshoots. The ASOCT and the LENSTAR or the laser interferometry based PACI always give you a 30 micron difference.
But all the diagnostic equipment nowadays, so while calibrating, they do it at 90% or 88%. So that helps.
In those dicey cases with a higher numbers to be treated and a borderline PACI, but the topographic PACI will always be more.
Yes, sir, but sometimes we are totally dilemmed. There's two different machines showing a different PACI. Like first case we saw, Galilee was showing a 530 PACI, while Sirius was showing a 490 PACI.
So
and we
topographic,
don't know what to do.
I'm talking of a topographic PACI, maybe a Sirius or a Galilee or a Pentacam. They always will show more PACI than the than these ASOCT based or the laser interferometry based scans, A scans, or the LENSTAR or IR mask.
Probably the high myope case, presbyopic correction might be a good option for that patient.
Yeah. So, but those presbyopic correction, hyperopic patients are more happy or myopic patients are more happy?
It depends basically. Means you have to customize the treatment for all the patients. You just can't go with the same nomogram for each and every patient. It's okay. That easy.
You can undercorrect that minus 7 by minus 1 because he's a 36.
Means for myopic patient, like in my presentation, for myopic patient, for dominant eye, if you keep it imetropic, then even myopic presbyopia correction also is very good.
So because in this particular patient, the right eye was minus 7 and the PACI was 490. Presbyopic ablation will ablate more.
Presbyopic ablation will ablate less.
Ablate less.
Less. It won't ablate more. Because the zone, the treatment zone gets compromised in presbyopic. Sure. Thank you. So anyway, we are discussing LASIK diagnostic. So the next topic in queue comes LASIK reject. So on the diagnostic, whosoever means whatever patients we are not able to do a refractive surgery. So LASIK in particular, so what are the other options in LASIK reject patient? So the next speaker is Dr. Vardhaman Kankria. He'll be talking about the decision making in LASIK reject patients.
The next one. Fifth
talk.
So hello. So at the onset, I would like to thank Dr. Darak sir for this opportunity to speak in his symposium. And also I would like to thank Dr. Saravati sir to let me go before my scheduled time because I have an IC in Hall B after this. So can I have my slides, please? So I think till the time the slides come up, I would like to ask probably Dr. Saravati and Dr. Darak if, like, what are the number of eyes or patients that you have to actually reject for LASIK today? Like, out of 100 people, how many are LASIK rejects?
It's almost 20% of the patients.
20%. What about
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I would also reject these cases. I mean, maybe 10 to 20% is definitely so.
Right.
Yeah.
So the point that we are trying to bring out is that there are a lot of people who are still not, they are not suitable for LASIK. So don't consider that you have learned only LASIK procedures so you become a refractive surgeon. You have to also understand the other procedures and the nuances of it and also understand when to use what. So before we start on the LASIK rejects, we have to understand that LASIK today is probably the most popular refractive surgery world over. It was in 1990 when the first LASIK was performed. And LASIK actually did demonstrate various advantages over the PRK in those times, like efficacy of treating high refractive errors with high predictability, fast visual recovery, with a very great satisfaction rate. And this is what made LASIK extremely popular. So if you see today, the patients, they think about refractive surgery, they think about LASIK. That is what they will come asking you. But what we have to also understand is that your decision has to be completely customized depending on variety of factors, and one size does not fit all. So all the patients are not suitable to undergo LASIK procedures. So that's why we have a huge armamentarium of the procedures available today. I'm not going into the details of everything, but just going to give you a small idea as general ophthalmologist what we are speaking here about. So who are the LASIK rejects? The LASIK rejects can be an underage patient who is less than 18 years of age or even more than 55 years, because probably would like to go for lens-based procedures that time. A patient who has collagen vascular diseases, has any active ocular disease happening right now, has unstable refractive error, is currently pregnant or is including breastfeeding, they become directly a complete rejects for not only LASIK but also all kinds of refractive procedures. But when we talk about the other factors such as the occupation, patients who are wrestlers, football players, rugby players who are in contact sports can have injury to the eye, we don't want a flap. If the cornea is on thinner side, we don't have the enough residual bed thickness. And if a very high refractive error is to be corrected, then there are issues associated with LASIK procedure itself. And of course, the most important thing is topographic abnormalities. So here is the first case in which it's a 23-year-old boxer, has a relatively moderate to high myopia of 7.5 diopters, has normal tomography, excellent corneal thickness. So basically, as we understand, they are always at high risk of ocular trauma and flap displacement. So this is a reason that he will become a LASIK reject. So in this particular patient, of course, you can go for two kinds of flap-less procedures. One is doing a surface ablation, which is a wonderful procedure as well. But for such high myopes, my procedure to go to in this patient is relaxed smile procedure, which is essentially a flap-less LASIK procedure. So as you can see in this case, what exactly is relaxed smile is with the help of a femtosecond laser, we are creating a lenticule intrastromally. And when this lenticule is created, we don't cut open the flap, but instead we make a small side cut. And from that side cut, the lenticule is removed. So whatever keratomelusis or change of corneal shape that you have to achieve is achieved without cutting the flap. So this gives you the advantage of LASIK without cutting the flap, and also gives you advantage over the surface ablation in terms of its comfort, the earlier visual recovery, as well as post-operative less pain as compared to the surface ablation, and less regression for high myopia as well. So of course, in this patient, as we have discussed, there is no flap to get displaced. LASIK, the smile compared to the LASIK is going to maintain much better corneal biomechanical strength. Again, this is something which is probably slightly not completely proven, but theoretically speaking, if we see the anterior stromal lamellae are supposed to demonstrate the highest amount of corneal stiffness or biomechanical strength to the inert cornea. So what happens in LASIK is that we are cutting the flap in the anterior lamellae and we are doing the laser. So we are getting rid of the most strongest part of the cornea. As against that, in SMILE, we are trying to leave behind the anterior lamellae. So supposedly increasing the or keeping back the biomechanical strength. So at the same time, we have to also understand that we don't have enough tools right now. So in terms of the biomechanics also, probably there is no single tool which is very accurate to demonstrate this, but this is probably a theoretical advantage of SMILE. But at the same time, definitely the dry eye is much lesser in SMILE as compared to LASIK. So a patient who is a LASIK reject because of moderate dry eye or mild dry eye, definitely a surface ablation or a SMILE becomes the procedure of choice, because the corneal sensations are also maintained much better. The corneal nerves are also, they are also maintained much better. There are various studies which have also shown that all dry eye parameters, including the objective and the subjective analysis, also show much better outcomes in SMILE as compared to LASIK for them. So when we come to the other scenario in which we have actually a thinner cornea, about 470 micron, 473 microns, and have a moderate myopia of -4 diopters, of course, we don't want to cut a flap. In this case, surface ablation seems to the way to go. The surface ablation has advantage of being minimally invasive. It affects only the necessary stroma, as we are doing the ablation only on the anterior aspect. There are less chances of ectasia as compared to the LASIK procedure. Minimally induced aberrations, let's say if the epithelium heals very nicely, and a much faster dry eye recovery as compared to LASIK, because we are not cutting the flap. When it comes to the surface ablation, now the term that we use is called as advanced surface ablation, and this is a term which is going to explain the evolution from the previous generation PRK days. So what is done in the advanced surface ablation is either we are doing PRK along with the mitomycin C, or we are doing what is called as AP LASIK or LASIK. So AP LASIK and LASIK are different ways of removing the epithelium. So what are the advantages of the advanced surface ablation is that now there is a reduced postoperative pain and discomfort. There is a minimal corneal haze as compared to the PRK days without the mitomycin C in those times. Increased quality of vision, again because of lack of haze. And the epithelial removal is the thing that I think most of the people are working on. There are various ways in which you can remove epithelium. Either you can do mechanical epithelial removal by blade or by rotating brush. You can do epithelial removal with the help of alcohol, in which you are actually using a diluted alcohol to loosen the junctional complexes of the epithelium with the underlying basement membrane so that the epithelium can slide very easily. You can use an AP LASIK procedure in which it uses a very blunt keratome. It is going to slide the epithelium in one corner, and epithelial removal can also be done today with excellent lasers with the transepithelial PRK. So this is one of the approaches that we do use. I use two kinds of brushes. One is Professor Palikaris's brush called as PAL brush. This is the one that we are looking at. As you can see, this is very high speed rotation, and you are actually getting rid of the epithelium very nicely. So there is another variation of the same brush which is also available today. It's called as Amoyle's brush. So after this epithelium is removed, you use eczema laser to ablate, use mitomycin C over it, and then put a contact lens in place. So if you want to remove epithelium by AP LASIK, so what is done? This is like a blunt microkeratome. As you can see, this is like a plastic keratome in which the epithelial sheet is slided off. And that is how the epithelial LASIK or AP Polish LASIK or AP LASIK is performed. What has really changed in surface ablation in terms of its ability to correct the errors, not only more long term but also reducing the haze as well, is the role of mitomycin C. We all understand mitomycin C has been very popular as systemic chemotherapeutic agent. It has seen to have long term cytostatic effect on the tissue. So this mitomycin C is used now with the PRK, AP LASIK as well as with LASIK. So depending on the amount of ablation that you're doing, the mitomycin C is used. In most cases, I use it for 12 seconds, but if I'm ablating more than minus 4 diopters, then I increase it to about 20 to 25 seconds. And for all the secondary corrections, like if I'm doing a PRK over a flap or over a smile, then I use it for a minute or so. So of all these different techniques of surface ablations, is there a difference of the outcomes? So we conducted a study in the University of Crete, which we published in JCRS in 2014, in which we did a contralateral study. Between one eye was done with PRK and mitomycin C, and the other eye underwent AP LASIK procedure. So what we have seen in both these techniques, they give similar visual refractive and corneal structural outcomes in patients with myopia, which was mild to moderate, up to 2 years postoperatively. This remains as one of the very few cases which are contralateral studies for these techniques. But it also brings down the important thing that whatever is the technique of surface ablation that you want to choose for this LASIK reject patients, you can choose any of them that you're most comfortable with. There are other reasons for selecting surface ablation over LASIK, apart from thin corneas, is that if you have a significant dry eye and if there is a basement membrane dystrophy. Anybody can tell me if there is a basement membrane dystrophy, why LASIK is contraindicated? What happens if you do LASIK in people who have EBMD or epithelial basement membrane dystrophy? These people are at high risk of developing epithelial ingrowths into the interface. So that's why LASIK has to be avoided in them. This is a very straightforward reject case for LASIK. In this case, in fact, doing a surface ablation becomes treatment not only for the refractive error, but it also becomes a treatment for the EBMD as well. Again, if you have any person who is in contact sports and army and has low myopia, definitely surface ablation is one of my go-to techniques. But what about patients who have very high errors, like minus 12? There has been days, I'm sure, that both Dr. Sarawat and Dr. Darak has been those early through these early days when people used to actually treat minus 14, minus 16, minus 17 diopters on LASIK as well. But today the norm is that you don't typically correct more than 9 or minus 10 diopters because whenever you are doing LASIK, there are certain untoward effects that you are causing for very high ablations. I'll come to that as well. So this is a patient in which the correction required is minus 12. And on the other side, of course, he has a very, very thin cornea, which is 440 microns. And the anterior chamber depth is excellent. It is 3.2. So if you have a high myopia more than minus 9, a hyperopia more than plus 5 diopters, astigmatism more than 4 diopters, definitely corneal laser procedures, including LASIK, is not possible. It should not be attempted and should be rejected. So in this case, if the anterior chamber depth is very good, you can do phakic IOLs, or if the anterior chamber depth is less than 3 millimeters, then the only choice is refractive lens exchange. Doing LASIK in very high myopias can cause loss of best-corrected spectacle acuity, can cause high risk of regression, high risk of iatrogenic ectasia, also induction of very high higher order aberrations. So these patients have a lot of halos and glare. So that's why the LASIK should be rejected in these patients. As we know, the phakic IOLs are artificial lenses implanted in the anterior or the posterior chamber of the eye in presence of natural crystalline lens to correct refractive errors. They are typically indicated if the refractive error is, let's say, not in the LASIK zone or the corneal laser zone. But you have to have enough space in the ACD. You should have a minimal endothelial cell density of 2,500. Cells and no, of course, active ocular pathology. And most importantly, the crystalline lens has to be completely clear. There is an important optical advantage of phakic lenses. Like many of my patients, for example, if I have done a phakic lens on one eye and happen to do even a smile on the other eye, or even femtolasic on the other eye, they always prefer the eye for high metropia in which I have done the phakic IOLs. The reason being the amount of clarity and the level of the high definition that they can see with this is much better than with any corneal procedures. And it's also specially because it is very close to the nodal point, and this gives them an effective zone of 1.25 times more than the corneal laser procedures itself. And of course, there is no induction of aberrations for high corrections that we have in corneal lasers as well. So, of course, there is slight improvement in visual acuity in this patient. So a lot of people that are probably seeing 6-9 partial with minus 14 diopters of glasses, probably they tend to see even 6-6 partial unaided after the procedure is done. And of course, with the cornea untouched, you have a better quality of vision in that case. Of course, there are certain complications such as increase in drogular pressure. You have to now, with the new designs of the lenses, that has really reduced a lot. If you take care, then usually the cataract is a very uncommon complication, but it can happen, especially if your vault is very low. So you have to just take care of those things and make sure that your workup for this patients, especially the sizing of the ICL, is extremely important. So currently there are different materials used. The silicone was used for something called as PRL. The collamer is the most commonly used one, which is called as the current ICL, which is the implantable collamer lenses. And the hydrophilic acrylic material is used with some of the Indian counterparts, like such as IPCL or refractive lens from the Appasamy, as well as from Biotech. So there are three Indian companies which also make it. They are decently good, I will say, definitely. Definitely the implantable collamer lenses are currently the standard of care. They are made up of porcine collagens, and they are currently the most biocompatible. They can treat up to minus 20 diopters of refractive errors. So this is a study which our group had published, in which one eye underwent phakic IOL, the other eye underwent LASIK, and for 10 years, or for 9 years, the follow-up was seen. And what was seen is that after 9 years, the eye which had undergone LASIK had regressed to about minus 2 diopters, and the eye which had undergone ICL was doing extremely good. So, and in certain situations such as this, in which the myopia is low, only minus 4 diopters, as you can see, the topography seems to be dicey. It is a keratoconus suspect. So you are not going to touch the cornea again. You will choose probably to do the phakic lenses. And in extreme ametropias, the bioptics are the way to go. If you have a very high refractive error in the tune of 26, 27, then you can combine the ICL also with the refractive surgeries. And coming to the last one, of course, if you have a frank case of keratoconus, then of course, I think none of the refractive surgeries should be attempted. The patient has to be observed for progression. And if the progression is seen, collagen cross-linkage has to be done. But after the collagen cross-linkage is done, depending on the topography, various refractive procedures can be combined in keratoconus as well. But in the view of time, I'm not going to come to that. So this is the last case I'm talking to you about. So for example, this is a patient who came with very low thickness of 460 microns, had a suspicious topography, and had about minus 6 diopters of myopia. So if you see, in this case, of course, we would not really attempt corneal laser procedure. We would have loved to do an ICL procedure, but the ACD is only 2.7, which is 2.8 is our limit. So we cannot go less than 2.8. So because it is also 2.7, we cannot do the ICL. So the last option remains as lens exchange. But in this case, this patient had multiple atrophic holes, had very strong family history of retinal detachment. So what to do in this case when all the options are exhausted? You should decide to do no intervention. So there are going to be LASIK rejects in which no refractive surgery should also be attempted and told to the patient, although they can be very expectant and aggressive in demanding it. But you should know where to limit yourself. Okay, thank you very much for your kind attention. Thank you.
Thanks, Vardhaman. Thank you, sir. So next speaker is
flap or flap versus flapless. This is my unbiased view. There's no financial interest in this products mentioned. In the era of modern refractive surgery, better excimer laser designs, optics and algorithms like tissue saving algorithms, then customized treatments in form of aspheric treatments for spherical aberrations, wavefront guided treatments for higher order aberrations, and recently the contour guided treatments or a primary topo guided treatment for primary myopia as a primary procedure. These have increased our horizons of laser vision corrections. Then there are better eye trackers, faster eye trackers up to 10-15 hertz. They have done our job much easier. And bladeless surgeries like corneal flap in form of a femto laser and a flapless recent advance in form of a Relax Smile. These are the procedures which we normally are contemplating. So with flap, the gold standard LASIK, then the thin flap LASIK or a sub Bowman's keratomyelosis or a thin flap LASIK, this is what we are doing mostly. And then the femtosecond LASIK, these are flap procedures. And the flapless procedures in form of a surface ablation, the Vardhaman has already told when the LASIK is contraindicated, or in some cases where we don't want to do any other procedure, the surface ablation in form of routine PRK, and then the advanced surface ablation LASIK, and the PTK, and now this trans PRK, all the softwares have come with for the surface ablations. These have made our jobs easier. Again, Relax Smile is the most recent advance. So conventional LASIK, it creates a now thick flap of 150-70 microns. This is a bygone era. Now thin is in, and we are doing all surface SBK, that is a sub Bowman's keratomyelosis, in form of a thin flap of about 100-110 microns. SBK combines the advantages of LASIK and decreases the disadvantages of surface ablation like haze and regression. Usually with a disposable blade of 90 microns, one can get a predictable planar flap of about 100-110 microns in almost all cases, and this is achieved as compared to the normal LASIK flap, which was a meniscus-based flap. So this is a comparison between an epilasic or a epithelial-based procedure, advanced surface ablations, then the SBK and conventional LASIK. SBK flap versus a femto flap, the comparisons can be in form of a smoother stromal bed with a mechanical SBK. The femto flap can be sometimes irregular because of the formation of OBL or the opaque bubble layer, and the visual recovery initially less than 12 hours in case of a SBK flap, while it is slightly slower up to 24 hours and maybe 48 hours in case of a femto flap. And the pain factor is present in case of a femto flap rather than our mechanical SBK. This is an electron micrograph of the stromal bed after femto LASIK and SBK. You can see the differences because of the OBL layer. Of course, it doesn't matter much when we consider the ultimate outcome. These are only initial things which we are considering. This is a mechanical 90 micron flap. Usually I mark them, and I am in habit of using pachymeter, which I don't have a online pachymetry, a routine laser delivery, and then when we are doing routine SBK, I really feel very comfortable in most of the cases, up to 40 K readings in flat K also. We are doing a good SBK without any problem. With different types of rings which are available, one can do an SBK in flat corneas also. Another advantage is a flap in flap. If you have another flap which is a thick flap, we can do an SBK in the flap itself. In a thicker flap, one can attempt and one can do a thinner flap with the SBK. These are the SBK's ASOCT images. One can get a very good 100 micron, 100 and 102 microns flap with a 90 micron blade. I have a 100 micron blade also. So one gets flap variation of about 6 to 12 microns in most of the cases. So most of the times I get a very predictable planar flap rather than a meniscus flap. As such, there are no specific difficulties, but yes, free flaps is possible in steeper corneas, and complications when we are handling thin flaps in form of flap wrinkling, stri and dislodgement of flap is possible, but it is rare again. A femtolasic, yes, completely bladeless creation of the flap, precise personalized thickness of the flap as planned, and the planar flap with sharp edges as compared to a meniscus flap of LASIK with dry corneal bed. Lower rise of intraocular pressure for a short duration of 15 to 18 seconds is another advantage with femtolasic. Cons of this procedure is that two separate laser platforms are required. That is a femtolaser laser and an examiner laser. You will have to have a bigger OT also if we have a refractive suite. And then overall surgery takes a longer duration than the traditional LASIK. Femtosecond laser typically takes around 15 to 20 seconds to remove the flap, but as compared to about 3 to 4 seconds in case of a traditional microkeratome. A slightly slower recovery of vision because of laser incision lead to minimal degree of corneal edema, which disappears within 24 to 48 hours. And a transient light sensitivity syndrome, again, this is a mild reaction which occurs between 2 to 6 weeks from the disappears with topical steroid. It's a transient phenomena. Relax smile is the thing of today. Everybody is talking of relax smile. It's a completely bladeless and flapless procedure with a closed environment procedure in which lenticule is created inside the intact cornea and it is removed via 2 millimeter peripheral incision. There is a very low rise of intraocular pressure for short duration. There is no blackout phenomena and lesser incidence of dry eye because less corneal nerve fibers are disrupted. This is the most important advantages of this procedure. There are limitations to this technological advance also. That is, first is high equipment and consumables cost. Very important in our Indian scenario. It lacks cyclotorsion control, limiting its use in high astigmatism. And then topo-guided and wavefront-guided treatments are not possible. Hyperopic and high astigmatisms were not possible earlier, but now with newer software, they may be possible, but with less predictable result than the recent and newer microkeratome and excimer laser machines. No flap means any significant subsequent enhancement will have to be done on the surface. We may create a flap by doing a side cuts, but then again it defeats the very purpose of doing a relax because we are not cutting the flap, and if we want to do enhancement, then surface ablation is the only thing which is more common. In my experience, we have been doing about 99% of our myopic cases up to minus 10 diopters. I do not go beyond minus 10 for any laser vision corrections. I've been doing this LASIK with 90 micron blades, and in about 4,000 eyes, we get consistently thin flaps of 100 to 110 microns in all my cases with a variation of 8 to 12 microns. LASIK and SBK or SBK is a mature technology which is still being refined all the time. Many of the important developments have already taken place, like advanced and customized ablations, profiles for most type of refractive errors, advanced eye tracking in 6 dimensions, faster laser pulse repetition rates, and cyclotorsion control. All these combined together give a very, very effective outcome. And relax is still a procedure in evolution with many issues which have already been and continue to get addressed. This is the disadvantage to my opinion. Another thing is more technical and clinical improvements are required to make smile comparable to LASIK regarding success rate and patient convenience. The better biomechanical stability pro smile has turned out to be a theoretically theoretical, as many studies show no significantly better biomechanics in SMILE. A recent paper of Theo Seiler in January 2017 in JSERS that gives limitations of SMILE procedure in form of almost slightly better biomechanical stability in form of coronary hysteresis, but it is not as compared to a normal surface ablation profile. So thin is in, and good safety and precisely predictable thinner flaps, SBK minimally compromises the corneal biomechanical stability. SBK expands the range of treatment, especially in case of thin corneas with higher refractive errors, and a much economical alternative where femtosecond laser is not available. A Relax SMILE is definitely superior technically and theoretically, more safe, and has better biomechanical stability as compared to SBK, but it is not exactly proven. Still, in the era of femtosecond laser, SBK, mechanical SBK is at par with femto LASIK. And Relax SMILE is a costly alternative to an advanced form of LASIK. Relax SMILE is economically viable only if you have a high volume of patients. I would rather prefer to do a good topo-guided SBK in majority of my cases, especially when I am not a very high volume refractive surgeon. Thank you.
Since we all are discussing refractive laser procedures, so I'll switch over to presbyopic treatment. I'll try to cover it as fast as possible, since we have another speaker also. So LASIK for presbyopia, when to do, why to do, when not to do. So there are n number of questions. Because a presbyopia, you know, by doing a presbyopic, successful presbyopic laser, you're opening another horizon to your practice. Presbyopia age-related, as we know, loss of accommodative amplitude. Hence, by definition, it's a universal phenomenon which occurs to everyone. So presbyopia management, we know, as usual, the conventional management by giving, say, spectacle or pseudo-accommodating, say, all current treatment, whatever we are offering in surgical or non-surgical, are pseudo-accommodative. They split the refractive power into distance and near. So there we can divide this presbyopic refractive surgery in cornea-based treatment and lens-based treatment. Cornea-based treatment, again, we can divide it into monovision kind of concept or a presbyopia, presbylasic. So lens-based treatment are multifocal phakic implants and monovision pseudophakia. Presbyopic LASIK is preferred over a surface ablation, basically, because it covers, it avoids the plastic compensatory effect of healing epithelium, as well as it gives more predictive results, predictable outcome in LASIK procedure compared to surface ablation. So first, monovision LASIK, dominant eye, you do a regular LASIK for distance, non-dominant, you do a for near. So it induces an isometric. A trial of monovision contact lenses preoperatively may help in patient making informed decision. Monovision LASIK, so as I said, you correct dominant eye for distance. Presbyon 2 platform, like this is with Carl Zeiss, which is available for micro monovision. So it dominant eye is targeted plano for distance and non-dominant eye is treated for near. Both eyes undergo non-linear aspheric ablation profile to induce the controlled negative spherical aberration, which will again help you to have a good intermediate vision. Multifocal LASIK, presbylasic, center for distance, which is not very popular because it requires a lot of neuroadaptation and it's not a very popular technique. Central presbylasic, center for near, center is ablated for near and periphery for distance. So minimal corneal ablation, thus suitable for both myopia and hyperopic patients. Multifocality is induced, so which is more physiological. In short, it's a pupil-based procedure. So the central, you create a hyperprolated cornea in 3 mm zone, which increases the depth of focus, which is about 2 diopter for near addition. With accommodation, pupil constricts and the eye will see through the central hyperprolate region. While looking at the far object, pupil will dilate and relatively seize the aspheric optimized mid-peripheral zone. So, as I said, it's a pupil-dependent procedure.
whenever you want to do a supracoroidal treatment, so basically take a detailed history, lifestyle of the patient. As I said, presbyopia treatment, always do it with considering the lifestyle, the requirement of the patient. It has to be customized. So check for refraction, visual acuity, dominance, detailed evaluation, rule out cataract, pre-treatment dry eyes. Give a patient trial frame with best distance vision correction at 0.5 to check to simulate a potential blur bilaterally. Only on non-dominant or monolateral treatment is planned. Always give a patient a simulation for his distance as well as near vision. And if your patient is happy, then go for supracor, otherwise avoid it. Whenever you are treating supracor in dominant hyperopic patient, so target dominant eye for, say, emetropia and near addition, supracor mild. And for non-dominant eye, always target for minus 0.5 and supracor regular, which equivalents to minus 2 diopter. So this is, in short, ablation profile.
So wants to go to the next session, so we'll just rush it a little.
Yeah,
bit.
Yeah. So we got it after, say, almost.
So just we'll rush through it so that we'll rush can get it. The session.
So basically, corneal approach is the best approach in keeping the supracor. I'll just go fast. I think we'll just, when not to do, I have already explained the contraindications. So limitations, supracor, lack of strong scientific evidence, spectacle independence is variable. And predictable, you can try it in, say, even pseudophakic eyes, where the patient expectations are not more. Thank you. I think we'll take the next speaker.